Well, it's been 62 years ago that I graduated. That's a heck of a long time. As I think back, it's fair to say that Carol was ready for me, but I was not ready for it. I was very immature. However, I do remember four influential things about my Carol years. The first was the wonderful friendships in my fraternity. They have been lifelong, and at the time they provided a sense of belonging, which was kind of new for me. The second was Janine Boyer, who was to become my first wife and the mother of our children. The third was cross country, my favorite sport. Maybe most important, the fourth was Dean Joe House. Due to Joe House's influence on me, I decided I wanted to become a college dean. I found that Indiana University had the most reputable graduate program in the country for this. So I went there for my master's and later on for my doctorate. IU is where I became a serious student for the first time, especially in the fields of political philosophy and history of higher education. Became my subject later on for teaching. Early in my career, I was very fortunate to have two wonderful mentors who stand out in my memory as still being here, although they've long passed. The first was Alan Finister, then provost of Wittenberg University in Ohio. As a member of his staff, I was invited to join him undertaking the first statewide study of private higher education in the country, and this was in Missouri. My second mentor was Jack Brown, then president of Lindenwood College. Jack invited me as a very young man to become his vice president and dean of faculty. It was under Jack's leadership that I navigated my way through the Vietnam War years and undertook with others a major initiative that changed Lindenwood from a women's college to two coordinate colleges, one for women and one for men. My third professional position was at the College Center of the Finger Lakes, which was a consortium of private colleges and universities in upstate New York. There I learned how to simultaneously work with multiple institutions of higher learning. We also initiated a major self-study that reorganized the consortium. The work attracted the attention of the Council for Advancement of Small Colleges, but was the predecessor of what later became the Council of Independent Colleges in Washington, D.C. My 12 years as president of the Council of Independent Colleges was the pinnacle of my professional career. Together with those leaders who followed me, the Council has become the largest and the most reputable organization of private colleges and universities in the nation. What became known as CAACE was the second National Higher Education Association that I headed. We were able to lead a major study of higher education that produced a report called Higher Education and the National Interest. We also opened a new CAACE office to serve colleges and universities in Europe and in Australia. And perhaps the most gratifying initiative has been a two-year project that interviewed 100 SAGE community leaders, resulted in the book called The Sages Among Us.
Gary, for many years, was one of the real leaders in American higher education. Played a major role in this thing called faculty development, which is now a mainstay in American higher education. More broadly, he was involved in professional development for administrators of all kinds. He also did a lot, and we did a lot of work together on curriculum planning, curriculum development. His final real contribution was in the area of institutional development. Gary did a lot in terms of saying, what about the education, ongoing learning, development of the people serving the students? And that made a huge difference. Gary is very success-oriented rather than failure-avoidant. I've never worked with anyone that had that keen commitment that Gary does to, let's have some successes, which means we take risks, and some of those risks will lead to failures. I just think Gary is a champion in that whole area. He is an extraordinary human being, And I think his experience at your wonderful institution made a difference. And he is the king of development, and he is the king of generativity. And he is good for the world.
My colleague and co-author, Bill Berkowitz, and I recently wrote a sequel to that book called Generativity, the takeoff on Eric Erickson's 8 Stages of Adult Development. Perhaps the most heartfelt and lasting satisfaction has been two small men's groups that I helped to start. That meets each month to explore issues of aging and ultimate life questions, something that men by and large don't do. The other group is located here in Grass Valley. As I entered my 84th year, the focus has shifted to the immediate and loving satisfaction of living a very quiet life with my 80-year-old wife, Bonnie, where I can share something that I've learned over my 84 years. Immediately, the first thing that comes to mind was nicely summed up this last month, the March issue of the Atlantic Monthly, in an article called Dissatisfaction Track. What is the track? It is believing that pursuing a lifetime of achievements will bring enduring satisfaction. As one of my favorite philosophers, Schopenhauer, once said, pursuing fame is like being a seawater. The more we drink, the thirstier we become. The satisfaction lies not in the pursuit of high status, coming on to it with your life, but rather managing our desires, especially helping other people. Personal failures, which do not kill us, really do make us stronger.